I'm not saying Obama's tapping my microwave, but those Hot Pockets seem to be awfully familiar with my sex life. It's 3 a.m. on Friday, March 16th. We've got a lot of shows, so let's get right to it. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. On today's program, the pit bull of comedy, Bobby Slayton, and America's number one political satirist, Will Durst. Three comics from San Francisco, old friends. Great show. And then we're joined by Judah Grunstein. He's the editor-in-chief of World Politics Review. His podcast, Trendlines, is available for download right now. He talks to us from Paris, and the reception is crystal clear. Thank God. Joining us from Sherman Oaks, California, is the brash, courageous, fearless, and beautiful Bobby Slayton, the pit bull of comedy. Hello, Bobby.
Hello, Feldo. Let me say hello to all your imaginary listeners. I love them very much. You know that. And, you know, look, I don't want to gloat because, you know, it's. I know you just had a big snowstorm there. And I'm sitting in my backyard right now. It's 85 degrees. I spent the day in the pool. I'm not gloating, though, because I know any moment, you know, that earthquake could come. I mean, yeah, I called my brother, my mother. Hey, how's everything back there? Now we're snow. We can't go to work. We can't do anything. And I go, I'm calling you for my pool. And then I stop gloating because I realize not only the earthquakes, but we have all the Mexican rapists. You know, the Mexican rapists are bad out here. The ones that Donald Trump is trying to get rid of, President Pumpkinhead. There's a lot of, you know, he's doing a good job so far. Do you know, before Trump was in office, my wife and daughter were getting raped by Mexicans maybe 15 times a week. My daughter, I just called it, only raped three times this week by Mexicans. So, I mean, it was literally, not a week went by, she wasn't raped at least 12 times, but three times. So, you know, it's a long process to get rid of them, the Mexican rapists. But I think President Pumpkinhead is doing a terrific job. By the way, let me tell you something else why I love this man so much. You know, you can't even walk your dog anymore. My dog gets gangbanged by these chihuahuas. There's these wild chihuahuas that dig under the fence, and there's a big problem. The Mexican chihuahuas are gangbanging all these fucking dogs. You wouldn't, you know, it's like the National Geographic special where the cow is eaten by the, you know, the whole school of piranhas. You can be walking through the hills here, and you'll see a Great Dane surrounded, getting fucked in the ears, the nose, by all these wild chihuahuas that President Pumpkinhead. Thank God he got elected. He's going to fix everything.
So ICE is rounding up the chihuahuas. That's good. Thank
yeah,
God.
Yeah, it's really... It's been some mess out here. It's a mess. By the way, before we went on air, I should tell your imaginary listeners, you know, hey, hold on. Hey, let me go get a glass of water. You know, you haven't fucking changed. I'm sitting in my backyard. I'm on my third Corona because I love the Mexicans. They're the best. They're the best people. They're incredible people. They're the best people. They make the best beer. And I'm sitting here with my Corona. You know, you need to have a drink, you know? I mean, you're the most miserable fuck I know. You know I love you.
I know. I am a miserable human being. I do not
when
know.
When I see you, well, every time I see you, I go with the Black Plague that came back. And you look horrible. You know, you won't eat meat. I got my grill going here. I'm making organic burgers. I got my beer. And I'm just so happy.
You've always been that way. You've always... knew how to live. You enjoyed life. I remember working Tommy T's with you and opening for you. It was a big thing for me. And we were driving through San Leandro. And,
oh, my God.
And you were going to headline and I was going to open for you. And it was sold out. And you looked over and saw a Little League game. And you said you would give up everything just to be able to go and watch that Little League game, to sit and have a beer and watch the Little League game. You didn't want to perform. And I thought, how does he have that ability to know what's truly important? Because you do enjoy
the Little
life.
Game, watching a Little League game was really important. Really, I don't think that was any more important. You know, it was important to do that show with Tommy T's. You know, it's funny. I'm going to play the Comedy Store tonight in L.A. I literally literally, I 25 years, have not done a show at the Comedy Store. And you know, the most famous comedy club, maybe next to the Improv in the country, and certainly before the Improv. But the Comedy Store, you know, when I first moved to L.A. from San Francisco, when you and I were doing comedy, you know, I became an Improv guy. I never played the Store. You know, it wasn't my kind of place, and I didn't like the comics there. I found them to be kind of creepy, and they've been calling me to do, Bobby, why don't you come in and do a show one night? And so tonight, you know, they got Chris D'Elia, Bill Burr, a whole nice lineup. And I said, let me go on first. I'll come in. Let me get the fuck out. I could go take my girlfriend out to dinner, and I could be home in bed by 11, you know. But, mm-hmm. I mean, I still don't want to do stand-up. I'd still rather be home. But there's still something exciting about doing it, especially in a place that I haven't been at in 25 years.
Well, there's a new guy. You know? There's a new guy booking the Comedy Store. He's great.
Well, I'm booked there, so I guess...
You're going to have fun. You're going to have fun there tonight.
Yeah.
You will.
I'll have a lot of fun. Unless I see a Little League game on the way, then I might stop and watch the Little League game. But, yeah, let me just flip my burger here. Oh, my God. Medium rare. Do you know there's a place in L.A. now? I know you hate meat, and I know you're disgusted by people that eat meat. But you know what? I don't eat a lot of meat, and it's so delicious. And I've always said, if cows could eat us, they would. If they were smart enough, if lobsters could eat us, if any animals could eat us, so fuck them, because they would eat us. But there's a place now in L.A. where you pick out your own cow, and they kill the cow. It's like lobsters. You pick out your lobster, you pick out your cow, and they kill it for you right in front of you, they wrap it up. It's so delicious.
You know, I would just go just to watch the cow get killed and leave. I wouldn't eat it.
Yeah.
I don't like eating cow, but I do enjoy watching them killed.
And
I'm
you won't
joking.
Have fish. No, right, am I right about that? You're a vegan, right?
Well, yes. I had pizza today. I had some cheese, which is not good for you. But, And you don't feel a little guilty looking at that cow and seeing the calves and the eyes?
I didn't see the calves. I didn't see that.
Seriously, you see something that's alive, that's looking at you. Do you think a cow has a soul?
A lot of people I know don't have souls. I'd rather kill them and eat them. It'd be great if I was like at a plane crash, like the Donner Party in Lake Tahoe, and you had to eat the Republicans. I would do it even if I wasn't that hungry. You know? But enough about me. Felder, what are you doing? What show are you working on now? You still, what are you doing?
I'm hanging in there. I'm, you know, the podcast is going really well. Do people walk up to you in the clubs and say they heard you on the show?
A few people. I get tweets from your show. I don't get, you know, I saw, I was in Philadelphia about 3 weeks ago doing a show, and Judd Apatow was there, you know, with Artie Lang and, Pete Holmes, you know, because he produced, you know, that show Crashing on HBO. So they were all doing a radio show right before me. So I got to see Judd and Artie, who...
Judd tweeted out that you're the best club comic in the history of stand-up comedy.
I don't know if he said that.
Yes, he did.
He's one of the greatest. He said something really nice. Meanwhile, he hasn't put me on any of his movies, so that's why I'm still playing Tommy T's. You know, but he mentioned your show. He said, yeah, he'll hear your Feldman's podcast. He listens to you.
Judd Apatow listens to me.
Yeah, I know. You know that, right?
Yeah, I've been trying to get him on the show for like 8 years, but...
Yeah, he was very fascinated by the story of Feldo the Clown, how everybody tell you dress like a clown and just do your act. He found that very entertaining.
Well, when you see him again... Yeah.
When was the last time you donned the clown outfit, by the way? You still have it?
It's in storage, and if I ever get access to what I own, I will donate the Feldo the Clown outfit to the Smithsonian. Do you remember the clown suit? Do you remember my performing in it?
I don't really know. I try to block a lot of stuff out of my mind. No, I think that in Anne Frank's diary, she even left that part out. She mentioned Auschwitz, but she didn't mention anything about watching you work. It was too horrible before you. She might have blotted out. I don't know. But no, I remember watching you perform in the clown outfit. I do remember you taking it seriously when people tell you should do it. But I always have these visions of you. You and I are sitting in a bar or a restaurant or an office, and we're working on jokes, or you're trying to hit up on some chick, and all of a sudden, you know, an emergency, something happens, and I picture you like George Reeves and Superman, where you go, excuse me, and you run out to the janitorial closet, and they show you taking off your glasses, and you come back out as Feldo the Clown, like, you know, like George Reeves did in The Adventures of Superman, to save the world. I always picture that, but it just doesn't ever come to fruition.
I love you, Bobby Slayton.
I love you too, Feldo. You know, it's so nice. I'm sitting in my backyard with my cold beer. I'm waiting for my girlfriend to come over. Did I tell you I have a girlfriend?
You had mentioned that, yeah.
No, I did. Okay. Well, I have nothing else to talk about then. You know, next week is 1 year that my wife has left us, left this earthly plane. It's been a year already. It's hard to believe. And I don't like to mention it to you because I know you get very jealous of me when I mention that my wife's dead. You're like Joan Crawford. I'm like Betty Davis, who got the good part. I know how you're like Joan Crawford, who feels that you've been fucked again. I got the good part.
Oh, my God. I am going through the ringer today with the divorce. I can't talk about it.
Oh, there's a plane going overhead. But anyway, what do you mean you go through the ringer?
Because divorce attorneys will not close the deal.
Last time I talked to you, you were keeping it quiet. You didn't talk about your divorce.
Well, I'm pretty much divorced. It's just the lawyers think I'm hiding money from them, so they want to get that. And suddenly there's some new I's that have to be dotted and some new T's that have to be crossed. And then I kind of explode at them because, you know, I do a radio show with Ralph Nader. I should not be talking about Ralph Nader and my divorce. I've trouble doing that. But the point is, every week I hear Ralph Nader, and he trains me not to keep my mouth shut. And then I'm dealing with these unscrupulous imposters, guys who go into family law because they lack the verbal gymnastics to become real lawyers.
Of course.
And they play me for an idiot. And, you know, most people are idiots, so they can be bullied by these mountebanks. Is that a word? Mountebanks? And I let them know. I let them know what I think of them. Because
did you try to work out something with this horrible ex-wife of yours before you got lawyers involved? Did you say to her, look, I would have been paying, you know, $50,000, $100,000, whatever, to all these horrible lawyers. I'd rather give you the money and we don't deal with these assholes. Did you try to talk to her about that?
I don't want to violate anything, so I'm going to remain mum about the mum of my children.
When they get divorced, a lot of people say, look, why do we need lawyers when you and I can work this out? Why pay them all this? Why should I pay them all this money when we can work something out?
Well, have you ever had a good experience with a lawyer?
Yes, a lot of good experiences. Yeah.
I'm not talking about dating one. I'm talking about having one perform, write a brief for you, not take one off.
Well, first of all, I have a couple of great lawyers. Not now. I mean, I have lawyers that have done some great little deals for me. You know, one of them got me out of some horrible deal I made in Vegas, and he pulled off a little miracle and didn't charge me a lot of money. And I got a lawyer now who, you know, he's on. You know, I'm not going to pay him money. You know, the beer is affecting me here.
Pro bono?
No, not pro bono. It's free. He's taking a, you know,
a cut.
He's just working. A cut. Yeah, okay. A cut.
That's not the word, but yeah.
Yeah. But he's just doing his contingency. So he's, you know, he's suing the hospital and the, you know, people that killed my wife and everything. So.
Do you have their number? Do you have their number?
The guy that killed my wife? Yeah. Well, I got the, you know, she was hit by a car in Mexico. I got that guy's number, but to get her to Mexico will be a bitch, you know. I've had good experience with lawyers. I know they're scumbags. My girlfriend's going through some stuff with lawyers who are awful people, and but that's what they do, you know? You can't expect them to be nice people. They're lawyers. That's why you kind of have them.
Now,
do you have a good lawyer?
I have a great entertainment lawyer, Jared Levine. I've had him for 25 years.
That's great if you're trying to fire your wife from the Tonight Show. It's not going to do you any good to get away from this cunt and keep your money.
Wait. She's the mother of my children. I love her. And she made me a great human being. So,
really?
Yeah.
I can't imagine what you'd be like without her in your life. She made you a great human being. I remember before you got married,
You came to my wedding. You and Teddy came to my wedding. You and Teddy came to my wedding.
We did?
Yep. And do you remember what I said? I said, I got up to deliver a toast. And I said, this is a very special week for all of us. Because anybody who knew me and my wife and my family know how much what is about to happen means to us. Bobby Slayton is doing the Tonight Show Tuesday. And it got a big laugh. Instead of saying I'm getting married, you had done the Tonight Show, with Johnny that week.
My one and only Tonight Show shot. But wait a second, I don't remember where did you get married? I'm trying to remember.
On the peninsula at a senior citizen center. It was a very beautiful wedding.
I'm sure it was.
Yes.
I'm sure it was. Well, anyway, I'll invite me to the divorce party. I'll bring something. I'll be there for that.
Okay, so this is a special show today. This is a very special show.
You didn't tell me what the point of the show today. Yes.
Okay. On our show today, Bobby Slayton and Will Durst. And for me, it's important because when I moved to San Francisco, there were two guys I wanted to be. And if you want to know my act, it's a fusion of Bobby and Will Durst. I wanted to do political humor, but in a kind of similar to Bobby. That was what today I have the two guys who had this tremendous influence on me, and I still get nervous around you and Durst. I can remember calling my mother and father up saying I was able to carry on a conversation with Bobby Slayton today. It was a big thing for me to be able to talk to you.
I'm speechless.
Now, are you like that with Woody Allen? When you're with Woody, are you... Or is there anybody who... Nobody. Nobody?
Well, I don't really... if I was hanging out maybe with... I don't know if I'd ever be speechless with anybody. I don't think that's in my genetic makeup. But I might be babbling a little. When I hang out with Woody, we don't really hang out that much. We have these nice dinners. No, and we talk a lot. He's a very pleasant, sociable guy. You wouldn't think that from, the press and from the... very shy, quiet guy. Mm-hmm. But when you know him, he's a great guy.
By the way, I know that Judd Apatow is listening. So, Judd, if you're listening, could you please pick up the phone and call Woody Allen and get him on my show? No, I was just...
You can't even get Judd Apatow.
That's the joke. I've been trying to get Judd to do the show for, since I started.
By the way, his show Crashing is really pretty funny. The comedians Pete sleeping on the comics couches, it's a really good show. I think next season it would be a lot better.
If you were on
if
it.
I was in it.
Absolutely.
Of course.
Absolutely.
Of course. It'd be
so
great.
Is there somebody, let me throw a couple of names at you and see if you could honestly predict... Like, I was amazed you were never nervous around Robin. I remember saying to Robin, I can't believe I was like a little girl. I can't believe I'm able to carry on a conversation with you. But from day one, let me ask you a question. If you met Steve Martin.
Right.
Would you be nervous?
I've met Steve. He doesn't talk much. He's like, it's like being in a room by yourself with that guy.
Okay. If you, what about Obama?
I don't think I'd be nervous about any of these people. You know, they're just people, you know? I mean, you know what would make me nervous? Maybe around, you know, Charlize Theron or Heidi Klum or Taylor Swift, some hot pussy, not the guy. You know? Or a Kardashian, a woman who I'd really like to fuck and then put the pillowcase over her head and strangle her. I've never really wanted to kill a woman, but I could see where you want to fuck somebody and kill somebody, you know? But,
all right, that's my next question that I have for you.
Yeah.
I wrote down some questions because I'm
oh boy.
I'm not doing, you know, we're all struggling. Everybody's struggling. Life is a struggle.
Everybody's struggling. Absolutely.
Everybody's struggling.
My
image of Bobby Slayton is you're fearless, you're courageous, you don't have clay feet, you will say anything to anyone.
That's not true.
Well, where do you...
You know, when I'm at, I won't really, like, you know, when I'm at the grocery store, I'm standing behind people, and I look at what they're buying with the cookies and the soda. I feel like, well, maybe you wouldn't be so fucking fat if you had a salad. I mean, I'm thinking that, but I would never say that to anybody.
Yes, you would.
No, maybe to Will Durst. He's put on a lot of weight over the years.
Well,
I don't know.
All right, here's what I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
On stage, you're the pit bull. You're pure id, pure anger, and you're fearless.
I try to be.
And you channel your rage and anger into this beautiful thing.
I try to. It doesn't always work out that way, but that's my intention when I get up there. To make people laugh. I don't know if it's a beautiful thing. But my intention is to try to get, it's just to try to get laughs with some of this horrible material.
But yeah. I have, but off stage, I've driven with you. You are not angry, right? Do you get angry in real life?
I'm always angry, but I don't, you know, I'm 62 years old now. I can't get in my car without getting pissed off at all the people in front of me. If somebody doesn't make a right turn on a red light, I really want their car to blow up and I want them to die. And my wife would say to me, but there's kids in the car. Well, you know what? Then they're going to have to die, too. And I don't want children to die, but kids die every day. And if kids are going to die, I want to be those kids. Because then they're just going to grow up to be like their father. And they're not going to make a right turn on a red light. It's like killing baby terrorists. I like when they blow up ISIS and they kill the children. Because the children are just going to wind up to be like their parents. You got to get the nest. You got to kill the baby bugs. You know? And so, yeah, I'm angry. But you know what? I'd rather sit in my backyard with a beer and watch television and watch John Oliver get angry or watch, you know, I'd rather just watch TV. I love being here, so I'm not as angry as I used to be. But it's not going to do any good. I'm angry at President Pumpkinhead because he's such a horrible human being. You know, I would like to see Trump fix things. You know, we know damn well he's not. You know damn well he's going to be impeached. You know damn well he's not going to last a year. There's no way he can. But I'll tell you right now, if he managed to fix everything in the Middle East, and he managed to kill, you know, the head of North Korea, if he managed to get rid of global warming, fix the economy, have the best healthcare system, and get rid of guns in schools, and then the gluten problem, and the Zika virus, and AIDS, he'd still be a fucking asshole. That guy was born a fucking asshole.
Yeah, and every time I see him, I think, he's ripping Bobby off.
I think that when I get angry, my rant's a little bit more focused.
Absolutely.
At 5 o'clock in the morning, it's a bitch about The Apprentice, you know.
Yeah. And by the way, you're also a great writer. Your Facebook posts are incredible. I mean...
Oh, I guess. I don't really post anything that...
Everybody should follow you on Facebook because you really are...
Oh, helicopter. They're looking for the Mexicans. There they go. Get the Mexicans! It's the police helicopter. They get them. They're rounding them up. Rounding them up. By the way, here's a group I never understood. Hispanics for Trump. Wait, you know, that was a group. They were, not since the Jews for Hitler movement. I've never seen a more misguided group of people. The Jews for Hitler, they were mixed up people. But the Hispanics for Trump, they're out of their fucking minds. I don't get that one.
If we were in Nazi Germany, how many years into it would you and I be saying, okay, now... Now he's dangerous.
I don't know. It's a good question. I don't know.
I mean, wouldn't you like, he started up in 1933. You and I, not to be bad taste, but they're, you know, there are a couple of people we'd like to see taken away.
Yeah.
What year? I'm saying 35. You and I would be going, yeah, this is not good.
I don't know.
He's going overboard. I mean, I get it.
What I was doing. But if I had a deli and they smashed the windows, a crystal knocked, maybe I'd get a little angrier earlier. I don't know. You know, I'll tell you, though, being a Jew and Hitler was one of the most heinous human beings who ever walked the face of the earth. But, you know, unlike Trump, he got stuff done. Trump's not getting anything done. Hitler at least accomplished something.
Yeah.
As bad as it was. You know, so you guys, I'm not like you. I like to look at the bright side of things.
Now, would you go back? This is the proverbial question they were asking last year. If there were a time machine, would you go back and molest baby Hitler? Or kill baby Hitler? You're supposed to kill baby Hitler, but
why molest baby Hitler?
I was trying to make a joke.
Oh.
Would you go back and kill baby Hitler?
That one might not have been the first thing on my agenda, but that would be a nice thing. Depends how many stops I can make. If I can have a layover, you know. Is it a refundable ticket? How much does it cost? You know, what if there's a fly in the machine? Am I going to get one of those big fly heads? A lot of things you don't think about with all that shit, you know?
But you know my show has a time machine, the Feldman Time Machine. Did you know this?
No, I did. I never listened to your show.
Oh, we have a time machine, and the way I traveled back in time on the show to buy art from a young Adolf Hitler.
And it's like Sherman and Peabody with the Wayback Machine?
Yes, but the way the Feldman time machine works, the dial is milk and then the price. 40,000 Deutschmarks, milk, and that's the time that I get sent back to. That's the only, there are no years. It's always the price of certain commodities. That's the Feldman time machine. So where would you go if the Feldman time machine was available? Where do you think you would be the happiest? I would be happiest during the dawn of silent movies.
I would go back to last night when my girlfriend was blowing me. That's enough. I don't need to go that far back. She took me out to dinner and gave me the greatest blowjob. Last night, go back to last night. How much better could it be than that? But
would you go back to high school? Would you go back to high school?
No. Not when I not only go back to high school. You know, I've never got to any of my reunions because I didn't like those people when I was in high school. I don't want to go back and see them again. I couldn't wait to get the fuck out of there. Why would I go back and do that? You know, it's like getting married again. That's like reheating shitty food. We go back and stuff in dog shit again. Maybe it'd be better this time. It'll be like it was last time. But, you know, come on.
But wait a second.
I can't believe your imaginary listeners are still listening.
If we could go back in time, you wouldn't want to go back to high school?
No. I would probably go back to maybe New York City in the 50s or 60s and, you know, listen down to the village with the, you know, the beat poets and all that jazz. I don't know, if I was old enough to, you know, I'd go back and I would do that. Or maybe I'd go to Hollywood in the 40s and I'd go into the Brown Derby or Musso and Frank's, and hopefully Ernest Hemingway or Humphrey Bogart would be at the bar and I'd have a martini. I don't know. And you'd go by Bugsy Siegel's house, say hello. Well, I go back to Vegas in the 60s when Vegas was great, because God knows how much it sucks now. I would have liked to see Vegas for three or four nights when the Rat Pack was in one place, Louis Prima, Buddy Hackett down the street, you know, and Elvis. And that would have been cool.
Now, you played Joey Bishop in the Rat Pack on HBO.
Yes, so that was the closest I got to going back in time. Yeah, and we filmed everything on a Hollywood set in L.A., so it wasn't, we couldn't go to Vegas and film anything because there's nothing left in Vegas without a buffet sign behind you or a bungee jump or there's nothing reminiscent. There's nothing that's still there from the old Vegas. Nothing. So they couldn't even shoot any of the movie there. They had to use stock footage for the outside shots.
Was the Rat Pack an idea that was appealing, but in its actual application, left the audience wanting. In other words, the idea of the Rat Pack was better than the actual execution of the Rat Pack. Is that a fair statement?
I don't know. I wasn't there, but from what I saw, it seemed to, you know, you never knew who you were going to get. Sometimes they were all booked together, and sometimes it was just Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin. And, you know, I think it would be really cool. You know, it's sort of like the execution of those Playboy clubs with the bunnies having martinis back in the 60s. I never went to them, but that would be kind of cool, you know. And the fact that women hate them would make it even cooler.
What is the angriest you were in the past week? What, like, was there a blind rage that you experienced in the past week?
I don't have any blind rages anymore, no. No. I went to read for a TV show that I didn't want to read for, and I said to my agent, sure, I'll go read for it. I knew I was way too young for it. It's a retired cop in his 70s, and I get there, and everybody's in their 70s. I go, fuck, what am I doing here? What a waste of my fucking time. But I did it, and it was just, couldn't wait to get out of there, so I'd go crack open a bottle of wine, and I get stuck in traffic for 2 hours coming up. But I can't say I was really angry. It's not worth it anymore. I'm 62, you know? There's no reason to get angry. You've been to my house. I have a nice house.
Beautiful.
Right? A nice backyard with my palm trees and my pool. And it's nice. I don't, you know?
And New York City, when we're together in New York, you're rushing off to find a pizzeria in Brooklyn.
Yes, always.
Do you think your life would be, do you think, I asked this of Jeff Ross, the Roastmaster General, who lives in Los Angeles. Do you think your life would be different if you lived in New York because you would not have to work the road as much, or you wouldn't have to go that far away to do stand-up?
Why is that?
Well, because within a 50-mile radius of New York City, there are so many pockets of people who can come out to see comedy. But if you live in Los Angeles, it's spread out more, so you have to travel to work, right?
That's not true at all. Because if you want to make a living in New York as a stand-up comic, you're not making anything. $25, $50 a set, $100 at the most, playing all those little comedy clubs. Then you got Gotham and Caroline.
I'm saying, like, within 50 miles of Manhattan, you can play Trenton, you can play Greenwich. There are all these cities that are pretty big that can sustain a comedy club that can fit, or a theater. Don't you think
it's very depressing? Going to Trenton in the middle of winter, or go to that shithole stress factory in New Jersey. It sounds horrible. Sounds awful. It's just awful.
Well, to me, I mean, my fantasy when I was living in San Francisco and Los Angeles and being a full-time comedian, I always thought of Robert Klein, who lived in Manhattan and would get on a train at Grand Central Station, go 50 miles someplace, fill up a theater, and be home that night. I don't think you can do that if you live in Los Angeles.
I think you can. You still have to travel, though. You can only play these theaters once or twice a year, you know, if you want to make a living. But you know what? I'd rather be here, and I'd rather get on a plane and come home to this. And I would like to have places on both coasts. You know, that would be terrific. Because I love, you know how much I love coming to New York. It's in my blood. It's in my, you know, genetic makeup. I've always been a New Yorker, and always will be. But like a lot of guys from New York, I love living out here because I like the sun. I've got a gym in my garage. I have a nice kitchen. You know, Whole Foods and Trader Joe's are a quarter mile away. I don't really need to leave this area except to make a living. And I've saved up almost enough where I don't have to work as much as I did before. I still got to work, but not every week at some shithole comedy club.
There's
great comedy clubs. Huh? There's the Improvs that I'm playing one next week. This weekend in Ontario, California, in San Bernardino. And then, I play the one in Irvine. I play Flappers in Burbank, and Mostly Beach Comedy Club, Comedy Magic Club, you know, Comedy Store Tonight, Laugh Factory. There's plenty of places to play out here at work, so it's great.
And the mood in the clubs, I noticed something about you, which is, do you mind if I give you a compliment?
You compliment me plenty. Keep going. That's all I care about.
The stuff you're doing on Trump is brilliant.
I'm not really doing much on him. He says pretty much about how horrible he is.
Yeah, but the sarcasm about the Mexicans, you've really given your voice properly to what's going on. How is, when you're in front of an audience, when you bring up Trump, I've noticed, but I'm in a bubble, I only perform in Manhattan, they love my making fun of Trump.
Of course, because everybody in New York knows what a despicable human being he is. They know his father was a piece of shit. He's a piece of shit. The piece of shit doesn't fall far from the tree. You know, there were slumlords. You know, he was a horrible businessman. I mean, you know.
Can I give you a punch up there for a second? The piece of shit doesn't fall far from the horse's ass.
Well, from the horse's ass. That's why his mouth is shaped like an asshole, so he can spit out that diarrhea. Like, it looks like an asshole. His mouth, that little circular, gumby, round mouth, so he can spew shit out of it. And the only reason I don't want to see him get killed is because that fucking fascist Nazi Pence takes over, who would probably even be better. You know what I mean? It's awful. They're just awful people. And his sons, Uday and Kusei, those two fucking idiots, those robotic fucking Nazis. It's awful. But, you know, I don't give a shit. Bring on the global warming. I don't care about polar bears. I've never woken up and ever looked for a polar bear. They're not here. I got 20 good years left. I mean, fuck the polar bears and the Eskimos and the penguins. I'm sorry. I wish I could care more, you know. But
what do you think on the show?
And fuck the coal and the coal miners. They can all go fuck themselves. The coal miners. Why don't you get a better job, you stupid fuck? You can get a better job working with solar energy, pay you more. But you know, and you, if you, these coal miners, you know, oh, my daddy was a coal miner. My grandpappy was a coal miner. Yeah, you dumb fuck. They ever come home from work happy? Hey, son, this is what I want you to do because this is a great job. You fucking morons, die. Anyway, yes, I'm angry. Now you're happy? Get me all riled up.
On today's show, I talk with Judah Grunstein. He's in Paris. And I said that I believe the issue of our time is universal health insurance. I cannot get past universal health insurance. What do you see as the most important issue of our time?
Well, that my girlfriend blows me again tonight, buys me dinner again. Two nights in a row. Three nights would be a trifecta. The most important issue of our time, I don't care. I've given up caring. I marched in Vietnam when I was 14, and I don't know how much that helped stop the war. There's nothing I could do anymore.
Getting a blowjob.
Yeah.
Are you giving advice, or do you let the woman...
No, I've stopped giving advice. I used to tell my late wife how bad she did it, and then I never got another blowjob again. So I keep my mouth shut. Our mouth open, my mouth shut. I would like to see health care for everybody. I think it's really important.
Let's get back to blowjobs. Hang on for one second. I want to ask you about blowjobs. Let me ask you about blowjobs.
I don't want to talk about this, but okay.
You don't give advice on how to blow.
I don't have to. My girlfriend's too good.
But have you ever given advice?
I don't have a, No, I've never given advice. No. To a woman, no. I know better than that. No. No, it's like when they're making me dinner, I'm not going to give advice about how they should cook. I'm happy making dinner, you know, and I try to keep my mouth shut over those things.
Okay.
It's very difficult for me, but I do it.
Do you think if we were in prison...
Yeah.
Do you think the blowjobs would be better in prison than they are in the prison of marriage?
If I was in a woman's prison, it would be great.
No, seriously.
I don't know.
If we were forced...
I really have so much on my mind, I try not to think about those things.
I'm just saying, if we were forced to give blowjobs in prison.
Right.
Wouldn't we be better at it?
I think so. I don't know about me, I would be probably. You know, probably better than most women because the guy knows what a guy wants.
Right.
Next time we do your show, we'll do it live and you can blow me and we'll talk about it. And I'll give you advice. We'll do it live on the air.
All right.
We can Skype it.
I'm going to wrap it up because
you should have wrapped up before the blowjob segment, but okay, whatever.
The last episode was 5 hours. And...
What, You did a 5-hour episode?
We've been doing, I've been in crisis. So the podcasts have just, they've been amazing, but they've been a little long. So I'm trying to, instead of doing an hour with everybody, I'm kind of cutting it down to 40 minutes.
Well, that's fine, because I get to go shower and get all pretty. My girlfriend's coming over. We'll go to the comedy store and out for dinner for a big night in Hollywood.
I love you, Bobby Slayton. How do people contact you?
You just give them my number when they call. Yeah, who cares? Bobby Slayton, whatever, BobbySlayton.com. I'm sick of social media. I don't give a shit.
Okay.
I don't care. It doesn't matter. I'm on Twitter, whatever. They can find me if they give a shit.
On behalf
you tweet
of...
What?
Go, give me your Twitter handle. What is it?
I forgot what it is. Mr. Pitbull of Comedy.
The Pitbull.
You just tweet it, they'll see it. They'll follow you, and your imaginary listeners will become my imaginary followers. All right?
They're not imaginary listeners, and on behalf of everybody who just heard you, thank you.
I'm going to be back in New York in May. I'll give you a call. I'll come back for my birthday.
Okay, you made everybody feel better. Thank you.
I'm sure I did.
That's
my job. That's what I do. All right?
Thank you, sir.
All right. Talk to you later. Good luck with everything.
Thank you. Bye.
All right.
Bye. Thank you.
All right, Felder, I'm going to go now.
If you're enjoying today's podcast, do me a favor. Please copy and paste the link and email it to all your friends. Share it on Facebook and Twitter and dig and stumble upon. We have a subreddit. I don't know quite how to tell you how to find it, but it's there. And I'm kind of learning how to monitor it. So please join me there. Friend me on Facebook. That's where our forum seems to be these days. And now, Will Durst. You know, let me push my chair in. I have not felt relaxed, I would say, in a long time. And I'm on the phone with Will Durst. And the minute I heard your voice, it was like a back rub.
I am. I'm the human back rub.
No, it's just all of a sudden I went, oh.
It's all going to be okay.
It's Will Durst. How are you? We always say buddy. We were saying buddy before buddy movies.
Before people started saying buddy.
Yeah. Hey, buddy.
People were saying boyo and pal.
Did Larry Brown start that? Larry Brown was the one who always used to go, hey, buddy.
I think he pretty much introduced it to the San Francisco comedy lexicon. Yeah.
Will Durst is the number one political satirist in America. He is.
I am, according to an article in the New York Times in 1987, I believe.
In my mind, you are out there punching the big guys. You're punching up. And
well, yeah, it's you comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. So you know, I'm not going to do jokes about retards, for Christ's sake.
Yeah. So how do you make fun of... Hang on. I have to do my joke.
Oh, all right.
Hang on. Let me... This is my new annoying habit that I... This is what... I have a joke, an ad lib. Hang on. You say you don't make fun of retards. Hang on. Here's my joke coming up. Hang on, I have to take a sip of coffee to clear my throat.
I think the entire audience sees this one coming.
Hang on. Hang on,
you don't need a railroad crossing at this point.
Ah, and now I will deliver the punchline. If you don't make fun of retards, then how do you make jokes about Corky? See, you thought I was going to say Trump, right? Ah, that was bad.
That was a very clever bait and switch there. I think you could join the administration.
Can you? Yeah. Well, let's ease into this for a little. Before we go, by the way, we're talking via microwave ovens, right?
Yes, I'm actually using my blender. My coffee maker is giving me notes as we speak.
Do you know when she said that, and I'm not trying to be cute here, I think that was the most intelligent thing she ever said.
I don't see why the guy had to apologize for making a joke about her kneeling on the couch without her shoes.
Well, hang on. I can't keep up with everything. When Kellyanne Conway was sitting on the couch.
Shoes, yeah. She was kneeling on the couch. She had her feet tucked under her. And some representative said, well, she looks awfully comfortable. And people thought it was a sexual thing. And I didn't think it was a sexual thing. I thought it was, she was on the couch without her shoes, with her feet tucked under her. It was kind of a weird, intimate, kind of a, not a publicity photo with the Black Caucus that you would normally, I don't know why he had to apologize. I have taken a brand new tact. I got in a Facebook fight with a friend of mine the other day who said that we can't make fun of Kellyanne Conway because that's how Republicans do things, is that they make fun of people because of the way they look and the way they act rather than their actions. And I say, fuck that shit.
Yeah.
We're playing by their rules now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you have, I'm getting a little feedback here. Well, we're on the phone. Yeah. Vicious. Be mean and vicious. That's, I say, if you're in the Oval Office and you're that relaxed around Donald Trump, I mean, that picture says so much to me. What's going on between her and Donald Trump, the way he's like this surrogate daddy to her, and I know that sounds sexist.
No.
But she has daddy issues.
But it's not sexist. It's sexual. That's different.
Well,
you know, anything sexual is, it's just that everything has changed. November 8th, we had a wake-up call. America shouted into a microphone with the amp turned to 11. So they don't want the cute puppy dog in material anymore. They want the hard hitting below the belt, the kick him in the balls material. So,
well,
grab him by the pussy. That's what I say.
So before we started, you said about political humor. Could you repeat what you said?
I have no idea what I said. It was almost 7 minutes ago. It's totally left my mind. I think I said people want to hear political comedy, or they don't, because I had a little gig. And someone stood up in the middle of my gig and started screaming at me, you shut up about the president. You're not being funny. And he got booed by the rest of the audience. And then his wife stood up and did the same thing. And then she yelled at me and she told me to tuck in my shirt. It was odd.
What is Dan Spencer doing at one of your shows?
Damn him.
Damn Spencer. I love him. I just figured I'd throw. I was thinking, who's a happily married, good and decent person? It would be Dan Spencer. The idea of him interrupting your show. But this is, do you remember what he did during the comedy competition?
No.
Where he went out with a water gun in his pants?
Oh.
Was it Sarlot or you emceeing that competition?
Well, that was not me. I would have remembered that.
Oh, it was one of those. He goes out. He's realizing he's not going to win the competition. It's a Tommy Tees and Concord. He goes out there, doesn't tell anybody he's got a water gun in his pants, and he just starts telling these old jokes. And each punchline, you know, he's got his hands in his pocket. Each bad punchline, he just gives one little squirt to his pants. So, like,
and it just gets bigger and bigger.
I'm surprised. Looking back, that could be an act. Dan Spencer could just, if he wanted to, he could just tour the country as the guy who pisses his pants on stage, and he would sell out. Are you there?
I'm contemplating that right now, and I'm not sure that I necessarily agree with your assessment.
Okay. Speaking of pissing your pants.
You are Captain Segway, aren't you?
Is it fair to say that you can be, have a migraine headache, you can be sick to your stomach, the minute they say, ladies and gentlemen, Will Durst, everything goes away and you feel great. And you get, step on stage and
there. You spend a lot of energy and you get some laughs and you get off and you feel worse than you did before you went on. But it's that unconscious sort of thing. I've seen it in athletes, too. There's a famous story of a batter for the Giants, an outfielder named Chili Davis, who became a batting instructor. And he was almost scratched from the game because he had the flu. And the manager somehow convinced him, and he hit 3 home runs that day. He wasn't thinking. You're not thinking when you're sick. And that the audience, if the audience can see you think, you're not in the moment, and they kind of lose a connection with you. But when you're up there on, not autopilot, but sense memory, you know, they're two different things, and you're playing by instinct. Yeah.
You are probably the second most devout Giants fan. Right behind your better half, Debbie.
My better half. It never has an appellation like that been truer than when you say that. She's the funny one of the family.
Yes.
Yeah, we're big Giants fans. We went to spring training. We're not rabid fans. I mean, our house is blue. It's not orange. But, you know, and we know people who are much bigger. But, yeah, it's fun to watch them.
I wish I could.
You went to a game with us.
I had a great time. He took my son for his birthday, and you're royalty.
Yeah. This year the Giants are, because of his work with the poor and underprivileged, and the kids with the broken and the not having and the lame. And Michael Pritchard is being honored by the San Francisco Giants at a baseball game this year.
What?
May 31st.
May 31st. Is that a Memorial Day? Are there going to be fireworks?
No, it's past Memorial Day. Memorial Day is the 29th, I believe.
I would love to go to that.
Wouldn't that be a kind of a nice little thing? Are you going to come out for Comedy Day this year? It's September 17th.
Nothing would make me happier.
It'd be great to see you, man.
I know. Let's talk about
podcasts that you could compile.
I know. I could be backstage.
And you can get a month's worth of work done in a afternoon. Pleasant afternoon in a freezing park in San Francisco.
I wish I could get into baseball, especially now where you want to get off the grid. You want to just ignore what's happening, but you can't.
I've found that I reflect on stage what people are feeling. People are coming up afterwards saying, thank you, I never thought I'd laugh again. I mean, it's almost like we're therapists up there, you know, shepherding people through their PTSD, their President Trump stress disorder. So it's almost a public service that we're providing.
Is it Trump or is he a symptom? I think he's a symptom.
Oh, that's an interesting question. Is it the chicken? Is it the egg? I don't know. Is he the manifestation of people's frustrations? Or is he just the right guy at the right time? Or is he, have people devalued intellectualism or study or education? And now they're going on instinct? You know, it reminds me of one time I remember Rush Limbaugh said, I know the facts don't reflect this, and I may be going against of knowledge and education, but people, I know what I know. And I think that's what Trump is. You know, I mean, you hear all these things that he promised, and I kind of forgot, you know, that he promised that people would have more health care and it'd be cheaper, and you know, he promised all these things that are like totally impossible. And then now, well, who knew healthcare would be so complicated? Everybody except you, again. So I can't believe people bought this bullshit. I mean, he's like the Picasso of hogwash.
Are you getting a little patriotic? I was watching. I am. I still believe in this crazy little country that I call America, because I was watching Rachel last night and seeing Daryl Issa being screamed at a town hall and then coming back to Washington and saying, well, you know, this health care bill needs a little work, and Senator Cotton being screamed at by his constituents. He's a Republican, and he says, well, you know what? Maybe we need to slow down on this health care bill. What?
Because he thinks it's too liberal. he's against it because it costs too much money.
Get your now,
why? Who but the Republicans would propose a health care bill to replace something that had near universal coverage? Who would replace it with something that would take down 24 million people off the rolls in 10 years and give a tax cut to the rich of $500 billion? $500 billion, so that we can give money to rich people, because rich people need more money. Only the Republicans.
And only America, because they've just made us so stupid. And they figure we can't understand the machinations of legislation, so we just go along. We're, because we can't spend 20 minutes to learn how the sausage is made, we just take what the Republicans say at face value, if you're a Republican.
So 70% of the people who are going to be thrown off the rolls, who are going to be won't be able to afford insurance or won't buy insurance, 70% of them voted for Trump. So I hope that vote was worth dying for.
Boy, we don't have to gerrymander.
No.
Just let Trump put all his...
The best thing that could happen to Democrats. All the Trump voters are going to die.
Could you try that for me and do it? So what are the audiences like? I'm in a bubble. I'm in Manhattan.
I'm in a bubble. I'm in San Francisco. We're in the two biggest bubbles.
Well, I think San Francisco is less of a bubble than New York. I think you've got right wingers in San Francisco.
We have one, but he's an indoor right winger. We don't let him out. But we take care of him. He mostly naps and eats. And he sits on the couch and stares outside at the top of the couch. And sometimes, you know, we let him out to walk around, and he'll bark at other right-wingers, but that's about it.
I think there's a libertarian strain in the Bay Area
that you guys, notice how I say you guys, notice how I sound like a New Yorker now? Hard to believe, right? But I think you guys...
But it's the same thing in New York.
No.
I mean, if you go to Rochester, or you go to Albany, or outside of Albany, maybe not the city itself, but, you know, you go to Burlington, you know, I mean, it's the same thing here. We go to San Leandro, we go to Stockton, we go to Modesto. It's like Kansas, you know.
Yeah, but I'm talking about New York City versus San Francisco. And I think San Francisco, which I love, I wouldn't be a stand-up comic if it weren't for San Francisco, and I love the people of San Francisco, but I think it's easier to be a liberal in San Francisco than it is in New York City. And I think that when you really scratch the surface in San Francisco, liberalism for a lot of people is fashion. It's cosmetics. You can be left alone with your own thoughts. You really don't have to confront your true ideology if you live in San Francisco. How does that make you feel, huh?
I disagree with your conception there. I think it's a misconception. I think San Francisco, I mean, I'm originally I'm from Wisconsin. When I go back to Wisconsin, I'm a commie pinko yellow rat. But here in here in San Francisco, I'm a Nazi. These people are quite mad. They are. They're, I mean, it is so lefty. I mean, Nancy Pelosi is considered a moderate here. She gets protested all the time.
Yeah, but don't you think, I guess what I'm saying is, when you live in New York, you're confronted with ugliness all the time. You just see people doing bodily fluid stuff in the subways, on the buses, and you really...
It's here, our homeless problem rivals yours per capita.
No, I'm talking about the cops pissing on me.
And the politicians. Sanitation workers, for Christ's sake.
You know what I guess? I have a theory that we'll talk about politics. I think once you leave San Francisco, you're so jealous that people who live in San Francisco get to live the way they do. You begin to frame San Francisco like, well, yeah, it's easy to be liberal when it's a temperate climate and it's beautiful and you're surrounded by nature. Go try being a liberal in the subway. I think I resent the fact that you have a beautiful life.
Yeah, well, it's all relative. You know, I mean, we're also paying $7 for artisanal toast.
Does it make you angry? You know, Larry Brown, I moved to San Francisco in 82, 83, and by then Larry Brown was infuriated with the place. Do you ever get angry at San Francisco?
I think it's when you fall in love with a beautiful woman, as I was lucky to do. I mean, there are good things that come out of that. I mean, you're so proud of her, and then you're kind of embarrassed because everybody's looking at her, and you know, it's just different. It's the same thing with New York. New Yorkers, I mean, the whole world revolves around you. You know, we think the same thing, that the whole world, but you're right. It's San Francisco. It's like an aging hooker, San Francisco. You know?
Well, no, I mean, the world revolves around New York City, but not the people living in it. And that's the great thing about New York City, is that it just reduces you to nothing. It's actually spiritual. If you embrace it, your ego just completely disappears. No matter how successful or important you think you are that day, you will be reduced. You'll be leveled to just zero.
in New York City. Whereas in San Francisco, you can go a couple of days feeling pretty good about yourself. Every day in New York is a reset. You just get up every morning, and it's you start at zero every day in New York City. No matter what, it starts at zero.
It's good to have a city that humbles you.
Yeah, not if you're weak.
Reminds you of your place in the universe.
Not if you're having a bad decade.
The city's like Carl Sagan. Billions and billions and billions.
No, I moved to San Francisco because of New York. And I you know, I remember hating Donald Trump in the early 80s. I remember Sidney Schoenberg was writing these pieces about Donald Trump. And I just, he represented everything I hated. Donald Trump, I hated him. Hated. And I remember moving to San Francisco to get away from Donald Trump. And I moved back to New York, and I can't get away from Donald. It's like, I feel like it's the 80s all over again with Donald Trump in my face. You can't escape him. Is there a part of you that just, when you scratch away the hatred, the xenophobia, the racism, the the impending Armageddon, isn't there a little piece of you that kind of likes him?
No.
So this is coming from a place of hatred.
Disgust, hatred, abomination. I'll tell you what pisses me off is living on the West Coast. He has a 3-hour head start on us. So we never know. I mean, you wake up and you go, oh, Jesus Christ, what fresh hell. I mean, he's had a 3-hour head start to light the fuse to Armageddon, you know? So you wake up every morning and go, oh, shit. And you turn on TV, find out what happened today. What, you know, what did he... He struck a flint that shot a spark to the kerosene-soaked kindling he called his staff. What did they do today?
Do you have the TV going? Do you have the TV on in the background? Or?
Right now I have MSNBC on. They're showing something. Oh, it's Spicer.
The Spicer Channel.
Yeah, the Spicer Channel. They didn't do this with Obama. They didn't have, you know, every White House briefing every day.
Yeah, because Obama wasn't putting on a show. He was actually doing something.
He was being president.
Yeah, why? The media is still complicit in all this, isn't it? Although, maybe they should be covering this since it is like a attempted coup, right? I mean, should they be covering Spicer?
Every day.
But should they be? Day. Should they?
No idea. No idea. Have no opinion. It is what it is. I just watch and I comment.
Is it a civics lesson?
I'm of two minds. Yes, we need to watch what he's saying and catch him in his lies. But then eventually it just, the media is saying that the president lied again. Nah, nah, nah. I love this. Obama bugged me, you know, and then he disappeared for a week. He wouldn't show up for a week. Nothing. Yeah. Hey, what do you mean about the president? Nothing. No, never mind.
Stop bugging me.
Yeah. Hey, Kellyanne Conway. Well, maybe they did it through the microwave.
Well, couldn't they?
He just makes shit up, man.
I don't know. My hot pockets last night, they seem to know a little bit more about me than they should. I mean, maybe, why can't the microwave bug you? I mean,
your TV can.
Yeah, my Samsung, right?
Yeah, I get a Samsung, too. What, oh, no, we got a Panasonic.
What would you be ashamed of if I had a... If you discovered that they were watching you all day, is there anything
that you'd go, oh, okay, that's pretty humiliating. Let me write a check to the government.
On occasion I drink Corona? Yeah, I think that would be cause for blackmail.
I remember reading the Star Report, and there was a section in it where the President of the United States, Bill Clinton, is described as, you know, placing a cigar in her vagina and then walking over to the bathroom in the Oval Office and masturbating into the sink. I remember reading this and thinking, well, he's going to resign now because everybody is going to just envision him masturbating into the sink in the Oval Office.
I don't have a sink in my living room.
And, you know, the next day he came out on TV, did something. I thought, I see the President of the United States. I don't see a man masturbating into the sink.
Sink masturbator.
And I wonder, I mean,
That was so Clinton of him to do it in the sink. You know, where it's contained and he could clean it up, probably use a couple of plies of toilet paper would probably do it. You wouldn't need to use a whole Kleenex.
Is there anything that you can be guilty of, and there could be video of you doing it, that would be a career ender other than my late show with Craig Ferguson? No. Is there any?
I never saw that.
No, I'm just.
Is that on YouTube?
I just throwing that out there. It went well. I just was grasping for something. All my TV appearances have been golden. But is there anything like?
People can look up my Letterman if they want to see a bomb.
When did you do Letterman?
Oh man, 87.
That wasn't a bomb. That's a tough crowd.
No, Letterman. Oh, I wish I had done more political stuff.
Yeah. 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 Here's the thing. I'm not going to criticize Letterman because it would be cowardly on my part. I think if you're going to criticize somebody, like, they have to be in power. Like, I went after Jon Stewart for his union busting when he was winning Peabody's and Writers Guild Awards, even though he was anti-union. And I thought, okay, if you're going to be a man, you go after somebody while they're, you know, when they can hurt you. So Letterman now, to criticize Letterman now, it's safe. So I'm not going to criticize him. But he should have had more political satirists on his show.
Yeah. Yeah, especially during, yeah. Well, that was a huge, huge thing.
They don't.
Yeah, but the great thing about Colbert is he understands now. He is not shutting up the beast. You know, I mean, he's letting it rage from, and people are responding. People are flocking to see him. I mean, his ratings are better than Fallon, which is incredible.
But are they booking? Is he booking political satirists?
I don't know. I can't watch the political I can't watch any of those shows because I'm too afraid of material leaching in my eye.
Right. Same here.
Yeah.
I'm not so afraid of it leeching as just making me jealous. And
well, both. Yeah. You know? And also the reverse. I mean, sometimes you'll see a joke you know you wrote, and it's on there, and You know, that's one of the professional obstacles and hazards. I mean, people are obviously trolling the internet, and some of the writers aren't as scrupulous as others. And so you can't blame the host, you know, because there's 14 writers on the show. But the problem is, you know, you approach that joke totally different now that you've seen it on TV, and you're going to think that people who have seen it on that show are going to think you ripped it off, so you approach it differently. Whereas if you don't know, you just go in with your naive, blissful confidence. And so that's another reason why I don't.
I've been reading about the internet and the sharing.
It's this huge thing now.
Yeah. Well, I'm trying to keep up with the kids. And apparently you can shop now. You don't need to go to a mall.
Yeah. And there's this thing called MySpace.
Never heard of it.
Yeah.
So with the internet and the new media, it's all about sharing. It's all about just give everything away, and the karma is going to be so amazing, it'll just come back to you tenfold. Stand-up comics were the original new media in that we came up with ideas. We didn't really get paid for them because, you know, when we were starting out. But we would get up on stage with our jokes, our ideas, and just throw them out into the universe. Never worried that hundreds upon hundreds of people would be hearing it each week and doing with it what they chose. I mean, it was public commons. We were saying, here's...
I can't tell you how many TV commercials I have seen, and I know where the spark or the little seed for that TV commercial came out of a comics routine from years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And the writers of the commercial must have seen the comic, and then, you know, years later, come up with a commercial based on that. I don't have any examples, but I can. Hey, that's Scheidner's bit, you know, or something like that.
Or they stole "Can You Hear Me Now" from my act, because I'd tell a joke and I'd say, "Can you hear me now? Did you hear that joke? I just said Nancy Reagan is about as much fun as a sneeze in the middle of a piss. Did you hear?
That was yours.
That was me. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Boy, there are. I could. Who's calling me? Oh, hang on. Let me. I have a. You'll like this. Alex Brazell, my manager, producer. I have instant messages to respond to a call, and I have three. Can I call you back? I'm robbing your apartment. I can't talk. Your wife's lap is in my face right now. That's what I do. You can customize the I can't talks on your iPhone. Hey, you know what my son did, by the way?
No, what's William up to?
He's in Germany right now.
Why?
Yeah, he's learning German, and he's with his girlfriend, and he's doing fantastic. But what he does is he showed me how to grab somebody's phone, and you go into settings, and under, I don't know where it is, but I think it's in general, and you can change, it's shortcuts. So if you type the word, let's say, LOL, you can change LOL to sit on my face. And so he's been doing this to his girlfriend, and then he does little things that are very subtle, like he changed late to early, and whenever she says, you know, I'm going to be late coming home tonight, it's just, you know, he says I'm going to be early, and you know, she's on to him, but. He showed me, when I see you, I'll show you how to do that to Debbie's phone, so she'll hate you, which is what marriage is all about. Yeah, so we were throwing stuff out into the universe, getting on stage every night. We still do it, and we say things, and they go out into the ether, and then you have this new generation coming up that says... steal from the best. Have you heard this new theory that there's no? I've actually seen a book in the library that claims there are no original ideas, and it's that cliche.
Hence, you're not taking someone's idea; you're taking someone's idea who took someone else's idea.
Right, right. It's and what that is. They say that. What is it? Geniuses steal? What is that expression? Craftsmen.
Artists borrow, geniuses steal.
Yeah, and there's this whole new belief that you should just steal things. I can't help but wonder if that is part of the new media, Silicon Valley, YouTube. Hey, just steal it. Just post this movie on YouTube. If they ask you to take it down, then take it down. But otherwise, just steal it. All of Silicon Valley was built on the idea of stealing content and not paying anybody for it, right?
Huffington Post.
Never heard of it. Huffington Post? Oh, the liberal, Arianna Huffington. She's a good person, Arianna. Lifelong Democrat, right?
Lifelong.
Yeah, yeah. And cares about the little guy. So what are you telling me about the Huffington? Oh, she built this website, right? That's all liberal because she cares about people, right?
And then sold it for $750 million.
And she must have cut all her... writers.
Contributors.
Yeah, I'm sure she paid, because she paid all her writers. She's a liberal.
Yeah, everybody
right?
get a taste.
Yeah. Without a doubt, one of the most detestable human beings on the planet. I'm not going to get started on Arianna Huffington. Then it just becomes, I mean, I just can't do it. But did you ever write
so
for
what
the,
are you up to? Are you doing stand-up?
I'm doing.
You're just doing this?
I'm doing stand-up.
How's it going? How are the clubs? How are the crowds?
I'm only working Manhattan, Queens, and Brooklyn. So as far as I'm concerned, it's going great. But I'm in a bubble. I'm afraid to kind of do my anti-Trump stuff overseas. And by that, I mean New Jersey. I mean, downtown, you know, there's certain clubs where they bring in tourists. A lot of the clubs have tourists. And it's my theory about Andrew Dice Clay at Madison Square Garden. I remember watching him at Madison Square Garden and saying, you could take all these people and bring them to a theater to see Paula Poundstone, and they would be quiet, polite, and laugh. It's the venue. That's the context. And I think that you get a lot of tourists coming to New York who voted for Trump, but they're in Manhattan and they're thinking, oh, I get it. We're getting a taste of the left-wing, progressive, neurotic, Jewish. This is good. This is a good experience. I'll keep my mouth shut. This is why we came to New York, to hear this kind of stuff.
Right.
But I think once you go to their natural habitat.
Their native habitat.
Then it's like, what happened to you? Where did this happen to you?
Oh, it was a corporate gig. Right. It was a wine tasting and annual dinner. And it was rich white people, rich drunk white people.
Yeah. And the one.
Yeah, it's going to happen, but I don't care. I don't care. I'm just going to keep, you know, this is my gig.
Right.
That's what I'm doing now.
What's the angriest?
And I got 4 years, and my 2 years of great material, 2 years of running and hiding, and then 8 to 10 years of re-education camp in a Montana gulag. So a portion of the proceedings of all my shows goes to fund a nonprofit whose mission will be to bury wire cutters along the Canadian border.
You have been turning out a weekly column. How many years have you been doing this?
10, 12.
No. No way. No. You have been grinding out a weekly column.
Well, it's been syndicated for 12. I've been writing it since the middle 80s. I got a gig at the Examiner.
I remember.
And so I wrote a column for the San Francisco Examiner for about 2 years. And then a new guy came in and fired me. And so I just got used to writing the column. And so I just kept it up on and off. And then
not on and off, every week. Every week.
Send it off to my mailing list. And now it gets syndicated by, it's on the internet in a bunch of places. But it gets syndicated by something called Kegel Cartoons.
Yes.
Not Kegel the way you're thinking.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
You're exercising my mind.
No, I can't
figure out.
No, don't do that.
I dug a hole for myself? No, okay. Sounds like I'm in a tight situation here. I don't quite know where to go with this.
You're stretching it. You're really stretching.
Hey, so the discipline of grinding out a column every week, which you have been doing,
the last one was a grind, too.
Is that something, if that job still existed, which it doesn't, when we were kids, you could be a columnist. Art Buchwald, Art Hoppe, Russell Baker, Dave Barry. These were syndicated humor columnists who actually got...
Even Molly Ivins.
And Molly
Ivins. Molly Ivins, yeah.
Yeah.
She was a political, yeah. Nobody wants it anymore.
Why not? I have a theory why they don't want it, but you go ahead.
No, what's your theory?
Well,
and then I got to go.
What?
Yeah, I got to go.
What are you talking about?
It's been almost an hour, man.
But I have no life.
Well, I have to take my lovely wife to get some food, and then we have a shared doctor experience.
Where are you going to go for lunch in San Francisco? I think
we're going to go to Louie's. Do you know Louie's up by the Cliff House? It's like 48th and Geary.
And the weather today?
Beautiful. 66, sunshiny. Might get foggy later on tonight.
It's impossible to be depressed in San Francisco. You can be lonely.
Oh, no. We live in the Sunset District, and it can get... July and August, I don't think we saw the backyard during the entire month of July or August because it was foggy, especially last year. Last year, the fog was incredible. So a lot of people get depressed. I don't. I like the cool gray blanket of anonymity. I like the fact that it's not sunshiny. The sun isn't coming into my... blindingly into my bedroom at 11 a.m. When I get up. I like the cool grayness.
It's the best summer is in San Francisco. That's the best place to be. The beauty of it is once you get past the bay, you're looking at 190 degrees, and what's happening is the heat in the East Bay is sucking ocean air, cold ocean air.
Across the little isthmus of San Francisco. We were just in Arizona, and we were talking to some people who live there. I said, what are the summers like? They said, it's okay until it gets into the teens. And they actually talked about the teens being on the 114, instead of, like, for the Midwest or New York, the teens means an entirely different thing. They're talking about the teens.
Wow.
I know.
Is it getting hotter there?
I don't know. Maybe incrementally. But they always had these spurts of huge heat. In Arizona, sometimes you hear about this more. You hear about it because it's extreme. And even the national news now, national news loves the extremities, the weather extremities. Oh, it's the storm of the century. They're always there. I mean, when did the national news have a chief meteorologist? You know, they just love, and you watch the local news, and the fucking weather person is on four or five times during the, just tell me, do I need a coat? You know, I mean, but in Arizona, of course, when it gets above, I think it's like 115, when it gets above 115 and 120, right around there, and it does. It, a couple times during the summer, it will. The tarmac gets too soft for the planes, and they start sinking. So they can't. They have to close down the airport. So, yeah.
Before you go, is it fair to say that where Trump is strong, where Trump has won, people should not be living where he is strong? Is that a fair statement? Or is that
It is.
All right. Well, let's plug your... How do people get your email?
I got no gigs.
No, they're your email.
Never again.
Your email.
Durst at willdurst.com.
And you can have your weekly columns just delivered to your mailbox.
Yeah, let me know, and I'll send it out to you if you ask to be on the mailing list. Or you can go to willdurst.com.
Fantastic,
and,
sir.
Thank you, David Feldman. Thank you for this opportunity to vent with one of my best friends of all time.
Well,
so I really appreciate it.
I worship you and give my love to Debbie. And
I will.
And we have to
I'll
do this more
I'll give
your
love often. To Debbie.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, buddy.
Bye. Coming up from Paris, Judah Grunstein joins us. He's the editor-in-chief of World Politics Review. His podcast is called Trend Lines. It's dropped today, Friday. Give it a try. If you're enjoying today's podcast, please tell your friends. Share it with everybody you think would enjoy it. And now the editor-in-chief of World Politics Review, Judah Grunstein. Judah Grunstein is editor-in-chief of World Politics Review. His podcast is called Trend Lines. It's available for download right now. He joins us today from Paris. Hello, Judah.
How you doing, David?
You've been living in Paris for how long?
In Paris, it's been about nine years now.
Okay.
More.
All right.
More. It's been 10 years now.
We are going to
in France for 16.
Okay, we are going to talk about the Dutch elections, the French elections. Rex Spillerson, I call our Secretary of State Rex Spillerson because he's from ExxonMobil, and we'll go over a couple of flashpoints around the globe if we have time. Very quickly, what is World Politics Review? Tell our audience what World Politics Review is, how they can subscribe, and tell me about Trend Lines, and then we'll talk about what is on Trend Lines today. You're dropping a brand new podcast today, Friday.
It's tomorrow, Friday. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, we're creating
the illusion. You'll have to cut that?
No, it's okay. We create the illusion.
Yeah, but I do it too on our podcast, but I'm a bad illusionist. I'm like Robert Kelly, the Korean expert. who was on the BBC.
With the kids?
From his home office, and the kids broke in, and he said, real life broke through my TV fake reality.
Hey, I don't want to waste your time, but when the wife grabbed the kids, did you see the video?
I did. I watched it. I thought it couldn't have been scripted better. But the sequencing, the timing was just for comedy gold.
But was she a little rough with those kids?
I think she slipped. I'll have to watch the video again. I got the impression at one point that it was just that it turned into the Keystone Cops at the end. The thing is, too, what I said, I mentioned this. I was on a France 24 Week in Review show on Friday, and they showed this as sort of the lighthearted clip at the end. The guy, Robert Kelly, is just one of the top Korea experts. And anytime he writes about anything of importance, anything going on of importance on the Korean Peninsula, he's one of the first people I turn to read. And when I first saw the clip, I didn't realize it was him, because I know him from writing and not I've never met him personally or seen him. And then when I realized it was him, I just felt really bad for him, because he's really one of the top Korea experts. And now this is obviously his new career is a viral video star.
Yeah, but the same way, I'm not going to mention the guy who's sitting in Obama's chair. We're going to try to get through today without mentioning the orange orangutan in
Voldemort.
Yeah, the guy sitting in Barack Obama's seat right now. We're not going to talk about him.
The name that can't be mentioned.
Yes. Okay. But what he's done is he's made civics interesting, if you want to call this civics. I think more and more people are paying attention. Maybe you guys who are deep in the weeds on foreign affairs, maybe having your kids dancing in the background might get more. Why not?
Sure. It generate a little more excitement over international affairs.
Okay. So very quickly, how do people subscribe to World Politics Review? Let's tell people what this great great service.
Thank you. First of all, World Politics Review is nonpartisan in terms of political allegiance. And we do sort of have a house philosophy, which I would liken to liberal internationalism. And so generally when people say they're nonpartisan, they're generally speaking more about their blind spots. So we try to be upfront with that. We're for a liberal internationalist system with generally free markets and democracy, multilateral cooperation as a best case scenario, but also understanding that the world is not covering the world as it is rather than as it should be. And just taking into account the reality and the fact of national interests and geopolitics, and that sometimes it's messy and there are compromises. So that's pretty much the approach we take to covering the world.
My theory is that if you stay home, you can be an isolationist. If you never travel, then it's America first. The minute you see the world, you get convinced that we're all interconnected and America is great and we can save everybody. The trick is not to travel. Then, right. You know,
my feeling is that there's nothing inherently wrong with America first, but it can't be America alone. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, the problem with America first isn't necessarily that there's anything inherently wrong with a country putting its own national interests or making that the priority. But that for the United States is a very complicated proposition at this point, because the U.S. Benefits in an enormous way and in enormous ways from having a sort of enlightened self-interest guiding its international engagement. So just as one example, the U.S. dollar is the global reserve currency. And that means that, for instance, during the financial crisis, or when the U.S. Congress is basically threatening default on the U.S. debt, at moments of great instability, the entire world turns to the dollar. So borrowing costs for the U.S. went down when it looked like the U.S. was on the verge of defaulting on its debt. Now, that's a contradiction in terms that's only possible because people trust the United States in a way that makes the dollar seem like a bedrock value.
Mm-hmm.
The minute that the U.S. is no longer trusted to be relatively impartial or to respect the rule of law in the international community, that kind of trust disappears. And so then at that point, the U.S. debt becomes a lot more expensive to manage. And the kinds of budget dilemmas that we're looking at today will seem like breadcrumbs compared to the kind of cuts that will have to be made. The U.S., if the dollar is no longer the global reserve currency, take a look at Greece to have an idea of what it looks like when a country actually has to start living in it within its means.
Mm-hmm.
We just actually ran today a country report, or yesterday, I guess, Thursday, on Greece and why its debt crisis is so persistent. So these are the kinds of sort of invisible benefits that come to the U.S. because of the fact that for all of the criticisms you can make in terms of Cold War practices of intervention, even in terms of the Iraq invasion and some real catastrophic decisions, for the most part, the U.S. is seen as a safe partner, a reliable ally, a country that for the most part respects the rule of law, isn't going to, for instance, go and annex a territory that belongs to another country, or colonize, for instance, Iraq, regardless of the decision, regardless of your position on the Iraq invasion. And I think that the consensus is it was catastrophic. The U.S. did leave Iraq. So these sorts of things mean that the world trusts the United States in the way, for instance, that it can never really trust China or never really trust Russia. And that trust creates enormous invisible benefits. And so America first, that's a defensible proposition. But then you have to actually look at it clear-sightedly and say these will be the costs. America first will mean that other countries won't necessarily listen to us as much because they won't trust us.
I think my listeners are probably thinking, well, I know they think, that's why they listen to this show and they're listening to you. They're thinking, well, this is why that guy in Holland almost did well this week. This is why Marine Le Pen is, and the guy, the orange guy here in America, you are talking about invisible benefits.
Right. Exactly. Definitely.
There's a price Americans are paying for being the global leader.
Right.
And what that price is, no jobs, low-paying jobs, no health care, a budget deficit. It would appear to most Americans that becoming this global power benefits 40 wealthy families in America.
Right. Well, I think you put your finger on something that's very important because the costs are very visible, right? Like all the things you just mentioned. And the benefits are largely invisible or taken for granted because they've become such a part of our daily lives. In Europe, the equivalent is the European Union, right? Where you have freedom of travel, you have no tariffs at all. It's a common market, so that a small French company, for instance, has not just a national market, and then has to pay tariffs to get into the rest of the European market. A small French company has all of Europe as its home market. One of the costs is, yeah, for packaging, you have to have something like however many languages in terms of the ingredients listed on your food product, for instance. but so that cost seems very visible. The benefit of a common market with the EU as a regulator is that when you buy something that's made in the EU, you know that it's made according to certain health standards, for instance, mm-hmm. or that the workers that made it are working in conditions that at the very least legally should be up to certain standards. Obviously, there's always people cutting corners, but you can be relatively safe. Something that's a product that you've bought is safe to use and won't explode, for instance, an appliance or what have you. So those are the sorts of invisible benefits, and the costs are this idea that Brussels is taking away sovereignty from European states. And then also there are also very clear failings by, for instance, the U.S. government and the European Union that aren't so much inherent to the idea of a federal government or a common market, but are just human failure. For instance, in the U.S., arguably the problems that the grievances that led to the election of the person who shall not be named.
Is he a person?
Yeah, it's always dangerous to dehumanize our political adversaries. The grievances that led to his election are arguably more a function of automation in the workplace, policies that led to heightened inequality. Those are not necessarily unavoidable consequences of liberalized international trade. The U.S. benefits enormously from international trade and access to markets. And historically, its foreign policy has always been about guaranteeing and ensuring access to other markets.
Okay.
And just one last thing. Yeah. In the EU, the same thing. The EU, for instance, horribly managed the Greek debt crisis, which has led to this sort of stagnant growth and the same kinds of grievances. And that's been compounded here over the past few years by its horrible handling of the refugee crisis and the migrant crisis. So right. You already had immigration as a real grievance among societies and cultures that have been historically more homogeneous than, for instance, American society and American culture.
Okay.
And so because those have been so poorly handled, that has created more grievances that have driven Geert Wilders in the Netherlands and Marine Le Pen in France. But that is not necessarily inherent in the European Union. Had the European Union handled that crisis better, we might be saying, see, Europe, the EU can protect us in times of need. The problem was human failure in terms of making policy and getting everyone on board.
So you've covered a lot of areas, and right. and that's why I have you on. I mean, there's a lot of depth here, and it's perfect for this venue because we can explore these issues. I want to bring it back to the needs of Americans because we're struggling here. You're in Paris. I'm in America. We're in crisis. And when you talk about globalization, I'm hearing from Thomas Friedman and neoliberals that it's automation, it's AI, artificial intelligence, that's taking all our jobs away. That isn't necessarily axiomatic. I think in 20 years, we're going to look back and discover that actually 3D printing and artificial intelligence and automation was just like computers and the internet and the automobile. It actually put some businesses and some workers on food stamps, but it also created a lot more jobs. But you need an industrial policy in the United States, the same way you have one in Europe, to kind of guide the economy so it's working in the best interests of the citizens and not the corporations. Is that a fair statement? Is Germany's success, is Paris, you're in France.
Right.
The workers kind of come first in Germany and
well,
France?
It's very complicated because first of all, I'd agree that there's no real clear cut statement of fact when it comes to some things that are as complex as the global economy and the impact of liberalized trade, for instance, on particular sectors.
Well, let me ask you: does protectionism is there any value to protectionism?
The problem with protectionism in the kind of market that we have today is that, for instance, right, let's take that small French company that I mentioned. The problem today for a small company or a small service oriented company, let's say, you know, it's manageable. You can make do with a small market, right? You don't need to constantly grow a company and have 1,500 workers or employees. You know, you can keep a small service business in alive through a smaller market. But when you're talking about making things like cars or steel or things like that, you really need an economy of scale. And so for these kinds of industries, the French market isn't going to sustain the French car making industry. It's just not going to do it. America is a little better as a domestic market because it's bigger in terms of population. It's wealthier. There's more spending, for instance. But all that's where the real problem comes in. If you start defending your industry, then obviously other countries are going to defend theirs. So you lose foreign markets, and then you have to live or die on the proposition that your domestic market is enough to sustain all of your businesses. Right. And then the problem I think too is that politics is, ideally you get a win-win situation, but it's not always the case. There's always trade-offs and there's always winners and losers.
That's why it's beautiful. That's why democracy is beautiful. Why can't we apply democracy to the lie of the free market? I mean, the free market is a lie. Would you agree with that? That it's left to its own devices, it's just a race to the bottom, and we all become third world nations because
I would agree that an unregulated market is not a good thing. That you need government to regulate the marketplace, that you need regulations to make sure, for instance, that asymmetries don't lead to, for instance, poisoned rivers and faulty products. The idea that you just stop buying dangerous products is not the way the market should operate. So we're in agreement on that.
What about a little protectionism? What about, did you see the movie Darwin's Nightmare? Did you see the French documentary Darwin's Nightmare?
I avoid French cinema.
Oh, it's pretty good. But the point of Darwin's Nightmare is eventually, with survival of the fittest, which was Spencer, he came up with that, not Darwin. But eventually, it's unregulated globalization, a free market, unbridled growth is a race to the bottom where eventually you're getting things made pretty much by slave labor. So regulation, slowing.
The problem with that is that we've actually seen the reverse, right? We've seen in China, which has become the world's factory, that wages have gone up to the point where now people are offshoring from China to Vietnam, for instance, or to other places, or they're re-onshoring to the U.S. or to Mexico because.
But Foxconn? But you think Foxconn?
There's always abuses, of course, but I mean the fact is, though, that global trade and global trade liberalization has pulled more people out of extreme poverty and has created a larger middle class around the world than 50 years of development aid. And I would argue too that there's competing progressive discourses here, right? Because there used to be a progressive liberal discourse of internationalism, right, in the post-colonial period.
By the way, I'm glad. I just have to thank you for doing the show because we represent opposite wings of the Democratic Party. This is very valuable to my listeners.
Yeah, I appreciate it, and I recognize too that probably most of your listeners are more to the left than I am. I come from the left. I've moved toward, I don't want to say the center, but I've just sort of I try to just maintain an open mind and analyze what's coming in from as many different angles as possible.
Okay, so let me just
finish that one point. So there used to be, I know, very formative for me was in the post-colonial period and that sense of solidarity with the what was then called the Third World, and now it's called the Global South or the developing world, right? Mm-hmm. And so liberalized trade has been really good for the developing world. You have, like I said, the decline in extreme poverty over the last 15 years, 20 years. You have a growth of a global middle class. Now, obviously, not to the extent that all the champions and the hagiographies would have you believe, but you know there are fewer people starving, and that's a good thing. And so,
really?
I'm not saying.
Are you sure about that?
Right, that used to be something the left fought for.
What about, are you sure that
keeping people from? Oh yeah, certainly.
You're sure
decline in extreme poverty. Absolutely.
I've read that. Absolutely. I've read that in I've seen that in The Economist, which is a neoliberal magazine.
They've actually the Economist has actually, to its credit, embraced certain discourses that have come from the progressive and from the left, from the progressive caucus and the left, in terms of, for instance, the idea that inequality is a high priority in terms of reforms to the global trade.
Okay, but there are numbers out there that would say famine is on the rise, more people around the world are suffering. China, what happened when you talk about being able to build an iPhone to scale up, that was essentially slave labor, where Foxconn had these women working at gunpoint in three women to a closet in the dormitories. They had to put netting up because they were jumping to their deaths. That's how sure. That's where our iPhones.
I don't want to minimize that. And there are always horror stories,
yeah.
Obviously. And I agree that, for instance.
So who's benefiting? Who benefits? I have an iPhone, which I need, I think.
Right. I have a dumb phone.
Okay, and who's
more progressive?
Right. So who's benefiting economically from this race to the bottom? Those women at Foxconn? That's like saying, you know, I look at
that's
that.
That's taking one example, though.
That seems like slavery.
Well, you know, in that particular case, it's not far from it. But, you know, you can't just cherry pick your statistics
and your examples. It does seem, and I'm pushing back. And
sure, but I mean, look at Africa, where extreme poverty has declined. There's still problems, obviously, and there's huge corruption as well. So yeah, a lot of this money has flowed into the upper echelons of the Chinese Communist Party or their oligarchs.
Our clothes are made in Bangladesh, and you know, in what is essentially cheaper than slave labor. Mm-hmm. To get a shirt made. You know, back during the antebellum period, when the South had slaves, you had to feed them, house them. You had to have somebody watching them. That costs money. Now you just have things made overseas, and that's a lot cheaper. So this race to the bottom is pretty, pretty devastating to the people who are doing the work and the people who are losing their jobs. So let me.
But what's your alternative, though? Because I mean, for instance, the if you're talking about a completely autarkic, self-sufficient American economy, I don't see how you're going to make that work.
Well, it's democracy.
I don't see how any. You have to engage the world, and you have to engage through trade agreements that have social justice built into them. Sure. But that's getting back to
TPP,
the TPP was really you know, again, these are thousands of pages of but I think it was much maligned and not necessarily fairly, because first of all, the TPP had nothing to do with tariffs. Tariffs are already low through the World Trade Organization. The TPP was in particular about reducing those kinds of inequalities behind what are called non-tariff barriers. So, for instance, making sure that regulations within markets are harmonized begun to be harmonized, so that, for instance, it's more expensive to produce in these developing economies. And the trade advantage of simply not having any environmental regulations, for instance, is reduced. Same thing goes for opening national government contracts, for instance, things like that, and opening certain markets to outside competition. The alternative, though, and this is where, you know, sure, America First, you can defend it, but this is going to be another one of those invisible benefits disappearing and very visible costs appearing. The alternative to American leadership in terms of global trade is basically Chinese leadership in global trade. And I can assure you that you're not going to see the same, even if you think the U.S. has no commitment or doesn't prioritize these kinds of social justice issues in terms of trade, the trade regime, I can assure you China doesn't value them at all.
Okay.
And your alternatives are pretty bad. But I think it's better to sort of fight for these things within the context of a system that has benefited quite a bit of the world. I don't buy the argument that it's only a race to the bottom and that it's only Foxconn slave labor. There are fewer people starving around the world. There's fewer people in extreme poverty.
I'm going to disagree with those stats. I've seen other stats.
I don't have them at my fingertips, but I'm willing to find them and I'll email them to you.
Okay. I'm really enjoying this. And because we're on the same team, but we're on different sides.
And I think also we have the same goal, because my goal, or what I think is a noble objective, is that there's more people living more comfortably and more safe lives with more connectivity around the world, right? So that you can go to other parts of the world and you don't have to feel guilty about people living in misery because you're not. So that's the objective. How do we best get there? I don't think protectionism or isolationism is the best way, for sure.
Okay.
Because we're living in a great castle.
Okay.
But outside the moat, people are really doing pretty badly.
Let me ask you a question, which are statements, but you're going to respond to it. So it's a question.
Let me just tie something back. I'm sorry. And then all of this, if it seems like we're not discussing the Dutch elections, for instance,
we are.
Because all of this stuff is exactly what's driving all of the political debates in Europe, in America. So for sure, this is all very relevant stuff. And you know, we saw it through the Democratic primary. The problem for me is that people just no longer actually communicate the way you and I seem to be doing.
Right. Well, actually, the Republican Party communicates the way you and I do. There are two wings of the Republican Party, and they're not afraid to have it out. That's why they're doing so well. The problem with our side is you definitely represent a Clintonian worldview, and I represent the Bernie Sanders, Dennis Kucinich wing of the party, and we're not having it out. And that's why
I thought that was the whole primary, was having it out. And I'd just like to add, because I hate what the Clintons did to the Democratic Party. So I don't consider myself a Clintonian at all. Mm-hmm. Basically the Clintons transformed the Democratic Party into the Rockefeller wing of the Republican Party, right? And sold out the basic constituencies of the Democratic Party. I do think that you could manage liberalized trade and not sell out the American worker and various constituencies of the Democratic Party historically. I don't think that the Clintons did that.
Okay.
So I don't consider myself a Clintonian. I would consider myself more a synthesis of those two wings of the Democratic Party.
Right. So I believe in democracy and the wisdom of the crowd. Given as a comedian, as somebody who's worked in show business, despite the putative stupidity of the great unwashed flyover states. I truly believe, having traveled around this country, that when you really educate people and you talk to them, they can make informed decisions. And I believe in democracy, and I believe in civics. The World Trade Organization has stolen our democracy. There are tribunals in, I think, Switzerland, where treaties are made that are not approved by our Congress. They can, the World Trade Organization can dictate how corporations are regulated around the world.
And that, I would contest that characterization.
Well, you can make a treaty.
First of all, the United States is a democracy, and the United States acceded to the WTO, or before it, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, actually was the founder of it. So the idea that somehow the U.S. is not democratically in the WPO to me is not very credible.
Well, hang on.
WPO is basically just a clearinghouse. It's a club with certain rules. And the rules are such that depending on where a country is in terms of its stage of development, it has certain, let's say, echelons or criteria for its tariffs. And you commit to not having tariffs above a certain limit. Generally, most of the tariff categories are kept quite below that limit. And the idea is simply that, to the best of our ability, we're going to try to promote trade and commerce among countries.
Okay, let me ask you. Okay,
yeah. There are trade disputes, and I know there's the whole investor dispute settlement, things like that. Yeah, that was a valid criticism of trade agreements. It's gotten attention, and now it's being addressed in trade agreements so that people are paying more attention to it. And in general, the abuses are not as I don't think that they're as great as some of the critics have said. So
you know more about this than I do, but
I wouldn't guarantee that.
But from my reading, as I understand it, the Senate approves all treaties with foreign nations. Under certain trade agreements that are currently going on, we've given the World Trade Organization the power to negotiate economic treaties that America has to abide by without the approval of our Senate. And that
I'd have to go back and check how the U.S. acceded to the GATT. Understanding would be that it was Senate ratified, but then
You're interrupting me, and I just want to make my point. No, I apologize too, but because I love this. Once you exceed your authority, that doesn't mean it's still democratic. In other words, the Senate has exceeded its treaty making authority, its constitutional authority to make treaties. And so a multinational corporation, as I understand it, can then work GATT, can work the EU, can work the World Trade Organization, so that American businesses, American people, have to fall in line. For example, it is conceivable that a treaty could be made that forces all Americans to only eat genetically modified food. That isn't the case, but there is that.
I don't think that's possible.
If there's a world treaty that is.
First of all, treaty is a technical term, right? So first of all, there are rounds of negotiation within the World Trade Organization. The latest one has been stalled because the necessary compromises are so far impossible to be found. But, no one's going to force anyone to eat genetically modified food or that's that sort of dystopian conspiracy theory I just don't buy.
What if you have no choice? What if the people making genetically modified food are so powerful that they can just drive the competitors out of business.
But then that has nothing to do with the WTO. Then you're getting back to a domestic issue of regulating businesses.
Well, it's enabling corruption that enables big business
and big money to influence policy. But again, it's like creating a bogeyman out of these global organizations that in general are actually creating certain benefits for American workers and American businesses, I think is counterproductive.
Okay.
I mean, you see the same, this to me is the left's equivalent of the rights of the conservative bogeyman of the United Nations. Right. Like the way the United Nations is like going to take over the United States, and the United States has lost sovereignty to the United Nations. So, you know, when you hear the right talking about the UN in those terms, it's very obvious that they're creating a bogeyman, and that it's sort of invented.
Well,
I think the WTO sort of serves the same function for the left.
Okay, I'm going to move on, and thank you for engaging me in this.
Sure.
Because
I don't think the WTO is perfect, or that global trade is perfect. There's things that need reforming, and there are things that need to be addressed. And at the end of the day, there's going to be winners and losers. And the question is, how do we, in terms of domestic policy, take care of the losers? How do we make sure that the people who have made out like bandits because of global trade don't just leave the people who have been impoverished by it on their own.
Okay.
And so I think that, but that's a domestic policy issue, and it's doable.
Okay.
I don't live in the U.S. anymore. I travel back regularly. I would contest the idea that the U.S. is in somehow crisis.
You would contest that.
Yeah. I mean, I was surprised. The whole way in which this narrative of national humiliation and national catastrophe took over the election, I just don't see it. There are states and there are regions that have been decimated because of lost jobs, but still, the U.S. as a whole is still a very, very comfortably healthy, powerful, economically prosperous country. The question is, how do we redistribute that prosperity and that wealth among ourselves so that no one is left behind? That's a different question, though.
So let me, and then we'll talk about the Netherlands and this.
I'm not going to have a whole lot more time.
I know.
So okay.
This is great. So your view of America from Paris, you're measuring it on a construct of GDP. You're measuring America based on numbers and determinants created by, pardon the expression, the elite. And Bobby Kennedy said, and this is really important, Bobby Kennedy said the gross national product, they used to call it the gross national product back then, measures everything except what makes life worth living.
Sure.
If you're unaffected, and it's not, I'm not accusing you of anything. You're in France, so you're not affected by what's going on in America. There are numbers that I can show you that says this is the wealthiest country in the world, in the history of civilization. But then I can break it down for you and show you that only 40 families are really doing,
And we're talking about inequality. We're talking about the concentration of wealth in the top percentiles.
One out of five kids in America are food deprived.
Sure, that's scandalous. But obviously being an impoverished person in a country that on the aggregate is hugely and immensely prosperous is still scandalous. It's probably even more scandalous. But at the same time, and again, I've only been back to New York in the past few years. But, when you have like gourmet food trucks in the street and just like entire neighborhoods completely renovated and rehabbed and you're not talking about a country that's in crisis. You're just not. Now, but granted, there are rust belts. I understand that. And I worked last time you took me to task for being holier than thou. But in the past, before I was in journalism, I was working in social work on the Lower East Side in Manhattan. I worked in Watsonville with teenage gang members who were Mexican immigrants and Mexican American second generation. And so. And in Texas, I worked in low income housing, you know, and I've seen these parts of America, and I've seen the people whose lives, you know, don't show up on that aggregate and they don't show up on the GDP. So I understand that. I'm not trying to say that that doesn't exist or that it's not important. It is. But again, I think it's important to say this isn't the WTO's fault. This isn't global trade's fault. This is, you know, when you if you have 40 families that have that much wealth and you have pockets of poverty in the country like that, it's not a problem of global trade.
Whose fault is
it? Just, you know, it's obviously a domestic policy problem. And at that point, you have to ask, why is it that, you know, the problem is, excuse me, the problem is, you know, I think too, if you give a little bit of good faith argument to conservatives, right? I don't think there are very many people who want there to be a lot of starving people out there, right? The question is, what do you prioritize? A lot of conservatives prioritize liberty and freedom over equality, and a lot of progressives prioritize equality over liberty and freedom, meaning that they're willing to have a little less liberty of enterprise or activity, a little more wealth redistributed, so a little more taken, in order for there to be more equality. To me, that makes sense. It's just. But you have to, you know, other people could say, well, I think we can achieve better outcomes with more liberty, and that liberty is the top priority. That's a valid argument, too. There's an argument for saying, you know, I don't trust the state. Built into the American political DNA is a mistrust of government, right? And so the idea that you can grow up in the U.S. based on this political history that we have of always keeping a watchful eye on government, and then all of a sudden convince people that big government is great, you have a certain contradiction in terms there. And so it's understandable that there's a large part of the country that doesn't buy that. And so to me, the question is, you know, you have to have a winning argument and you have to convince people. And I think that, you know, and it's complicated. It's hard. You know, you look at Obamacare or the American Care Act, right?
Mm-hmm. Healthcare is more complicated than I thought.
Right. And you know, people agreed with everything about the program, except when it came to calling it Obamacare, and then they didn't like it. You know, so sometimes it's hard. People like a policy, they like the effect of a policy, but they don't like the policy because it's against their principles.
Okay.
So, you know, human beings are complicated.
Let me tell you, right.
And it's hard to convince people. But you have to convince them if you believe in democracy, right?
Right. And I know we're out of time. There are three things I just want to say. Human beings are complicated. Democracy is complicated. There's nuance. So you tend to bring up like these binary choices, like if America steps back, then China becomes the dominant world power and the yuan becomes the currency of the world. And I say, there's nuance. It's complicated. That's one thing that I want to say. That's not binary. It's not.
I'd agree with that. I didn't say China would necessarily dominate the world. But I said they would sort of set the agenda in terms of global trade regimes.
Well, but that's binary. That's a Manichaean.
Well, you see
that's
it happening already in Asia.
But that's you see parts of that happening. It's Manichaean. Sure. It's how we ended up in Iraq. If we don't invade Iraq, then we will be victims of another 9/11.
But if you look at global trade negotiations, the America's on one side in terms of what's called high quality trade agreements, where you have issues like regulations and open access to markets and things like that. And China's on the other end, where all they want to do is focus on non-tariff on tariff barriers, getting them as low as possible.
Okay,
so it is kind of binary when it comes to that. I don't think the outcomes are binary because people don't trust China. So in Asia, people want more America.
Okay, so let me just,
if America wants to come home, they're not going to get it. That's all I'm saying.
Right. This has been great. I just want to say one more thing, just so people listening, and I think it's important for them to know what I believe.
Yeah.
You know, I believe in the 80-20 rule. You isolate the two things that, well, that's not really what the 80-20 rule is, but I believe in two things. I get up every day and I think about the 99% and how unfair it is. That's what I believe. And I believe in universal health insurance. I believe that the issue of our time, this is what I believe, that universal health insurance is the issue of our time, that we are slaves to our jobs because they provide us health insurance. And once you have universal health insurance, you will crack open the animal spirits. People will quit their jobs because they won't be beholden to their boss to stay alive, and we will see new innovation. The lack of health insurance in this country, to me, is the issue of our time. So, although I believe in nuance, and I don't believe...
Yeah, that sounds kind of binary. They have universal health coverage here in France, and I don't see too many animal spirits on the loose.
That's another... Okay, all right.
Sorry to be kind of cynical. I'll tell you this. You know what, David? And this I would like... I'd like to say to your listeners, because I know probably most of your listeners don't agree with a lot of what I said, or what I say. Living in France can make you reconsider a lot of the sort of progressive leftist shibboleths that I know I grew up on and things like that.
Well, what's the GDP of France? Isn't it like the fifth
or sixth? But
it's pretty good for a social. That's pretty good for a socialist nation.
It's not a socialist nation anymore. I think the state has maybe 10% or 15% holding in the electric, in some of the utilities, and that's about it at this point.
Yeah, but there's a safety net.
Yeah, no, certainly there's a safety net, and it's productive. No, but at the
same time, what's Germany's GDP?
Germany is higher than that. I think France is in the $2 trillion a year, and Germany must be in the 2.5.
And Germany has labor leaders who sit on the board of directors of every...
It's a different culture. Yeah, have Mick jobs. I mean, Germany 10 years ago was the sick man of Europe in permanent recession or permanent stagnation until they did a reform, and it was the left that did the reform that kind of broke that sort of stranglehold.
And when they were in a permanent recession, the same way Japan is in a permanent recession.
I don't want to say permanent recession with Germany, but at least stagnation, because I don't know.
But Japan is in a permanent recession
for other reasons.
How are the people of Japan doing?
I was actually in Tokyo last year, but Japan is a dynamic country with a lot of innovation,
so
but it's
numbers,
other reasons.
But so, okay, so the but, numbers.
But one last point in terms of Germany, one of the major problems for Germany is that what Germany did was it negotiated wages down. It used controlling wages to increase its competitiveness as an exporter. That's how Germany became the primary exporter of Europe. And it got wages down by getting rid of a lot of high quality jobs and turning them into temp work. So you have a lot of people working two or three temp positions to make ends meet. So, you know, the social welfare state has been under pressure for the last 30 years. We know this,
but
it went too far. Probably the social welfare state went too far in one direction. The pendulum swung too far in one direction. Now it's swung too far in the other direction. And we see that in terms of the accumulation of wealth in the top echelons of societies. You see that in the sort of precariousness that people are living through. And so it's a question of getting that pendulum back to the middle. Now, say what you will about the likely outcomes of his policies, right? But if you take away the racism and the sort of immigrant bashing from his campaign, he who shall not be named sort of campaigned on something along the same lines. Things have gone too far in the other direction, and we've got to take care of American workers now. So I think there's a – I think that argument has won, right? We know now that the pendulum swung too far in terms of liberalized trade, in terms of the concentration of wealth. And so now the real fight is how do we get back to a better medium? Is it through America First, America alone? Or is it through engagement with the world and redistributive policies at home? So I think that's where the real argument is. And I think, for instance, for me, Bernie Sanders went a little too far to the extreme and a little too much economic nationalism for my taste because of my sense of the progressive movement always having a very strong internationalist component in terms of international justice. And the U.S. is a crucial element in terms of rule of law in the world and maintaining international justice, even if we've abused our power and even if we have a history that in some ways is scandalous in the developing world. I agree.
Okay.
But at the same time, so I think what I'm saying is everything you're saying, those arguments have won on both sides of the political spectrum. But now we have to actually dial it in and get to where we're actually having a more just approach to solving them.
Okay, I'm going to give you the last word. This has been fantastic. We've been talking with Judah Grunstein. He's the editor-in-chief of World Politics Review. Trendlines is his podcast.
It's our weekly podcast for the journal, and we go over a topic of the week, and then we have a special report which focuses on one of our in-depth articles from the week that's usually a little bit off the headlines, and so it offers people a chance to learn about a part of the world or a topic or an issue mm-hmm. that might not be getting a lot of attention elsewhere but is really compelling and interesting. Right. It's a great segment.
Right. This has been invigorating. Let me just say something, and then you get the last word, because this wasn't a debate, but
no.
we don't agree. I think you and I, and this is a great way to arrive at how I want to vote. And listening to you talk, and this is the last thing I'm going to say, I hearken back to what Bobby Kennedy said about the gross national product. It measures everything except what makes life worth living. And you, when you talk about Germany and Japan, Japan has been in a permanent recession, I think, since the 90s. It's zero growth. And by saying that and trying to adjust their economy, you become a slave to your yardstick. You become a slave to your measurement. You say, oh, Japan is failing. Look at its economic growth. Well, there are other ways to measure how a country.
You've got to look into what you're saying. Japan has had deflation for a long time, but I don't think they've been in constant recession.
Well, they've been hovering. It's been stagnant, maybe. Yeah. So, I mean, it might as well be a recession. Right. Japan might as well be a recession. And the point I'm making is. Let me just finish my point, and then I'm done. I promise.
Yeah,
okay. This is the point I'm making.
Okay.
We become slaves to our yardstick. If everything is filtered through a number that a country or a corporation has to hit, then everything falls by the wayside, and that number, it's meaningless. And I think you have to look
at... And it doesn't measure the important stuff, like you said.
Well, but it also doesn't measure the economy.
Right.
It really doesn't. The way we measure an economy, we choose. It's a construct. We choose what's important in an economy and whether or not it's worth measuring.
Sure. And even the way we measure GDP, where someone dying of a very costly illness actually improves GDP because of all the money that's spent on their care.
So these are numbers that are a human construct that reflect values of a certain type, but not necessarily the 99%. So we're using a yardstick that the 1% lives by. The 99%, we don't live by that yardstick. And so let's not be slaves to GDP and false unemployment numbers. How are the question is, when Germany goes into a massive recession, how are the people doing? They still have health care, dental.
I'll give you an example, right? And then I do have to go. I'll take the last word. The example I'll give you, which bears out your point, is that, for instance, after the global financial crisis, the United States contracted dramatically, and then whereas France contracted less dramatically, less exposure, but also a more ample social welfare safety net. But in the meantime, the United States rebounds much more dynamically, whereas France has stagnated. And that's the difference, I think, that you have. When you have more oxygen, you have a little more of more volatility and more precariousness, for sure. But you also have a lot more dynamism and a lot more innovation. So that would be in answer to what you said. For my last word, do I get it?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'll have two last words. The first is, I want to thank you. Because I really enjoy the conversation.
Me too.
And hopefully
Me too.
I'm not exasperating your listeners too
no,
much.
No, no, no.
But
it's great.
The second thing that I would, the real last word that I would say in terms of what this conversation makes me feel like is that possibly our biggest, what we're suffering from the most right now is a lack of political courage and a lack of political offer. And that we have a lot of people on the extremes or that are pulling in different directions, and we don't have someone who's able to say, you know what, that's a good part of that argument, and that's a good part of that argument. We didn't have a very rich field this year, last year. And that was my big regret, that there wasn't someone to say, listen, we do need to fix things. This is how we're going to do it, but we're not going to throw out all the benefits just to address the disadvantages. We have to fix them in a way that we try and hold on to as many of the benefits, and that we can do it. So for me, the big problem these days is that you have a bunch of populists and nationalists that are kind of sucking up all the oxygen, and that we don't just have that kind of rich discourse and political option that the rest of us need.
Yeah. You have the last word, but I'm going to wrap it up by giving you a compliment. Is that okay?
We're not going to argue. No to a compliment.
Okay, good. And I hope you come back. We just conducted a master's class in discourse, which is sorely lacking in America. This was a primer on how two people who care can arrive at their own truth. I'm not trying to win. You're not trying to win. You know what I'm trying to do? I'm trying to figure out how to vote in the next election, because that's all that matters. And because of this conversation, you've inspired me to read World Politics Review and listen to your podcast, Trend Lines. But getting off the line with you and finishing up this show, you have inspired me to lie down on the couch, get out my Kindle, and start reading.
Right on.
And that's what this show is all about. Nobody won. Nobody screamed. Nobody fought. There was a little exasperation. I wanted to get some points in. But this, you conducted, and I facilitated, a master's class in discourse. And if Americans can learn to talk to their crazy uncles this way, we'll make more informed decisions on election day. Judah Grunstein, thank you so much for doing this. Everybody should download your podcast, Trend Lines, and go to World Politics Review on the web. Thank you. Please come back.
Thank you. It's been a great pleasure.
Great. Thank you. That's our show. Thank you for listening. I want to thank Bobby Slayton, Will Durst, and Judah Grunstein for coming on the show and elevating the conversation as well as the comedy. This was an excellent show, as always. Thank you for listening. It means a lot to me. It really does. I answer all your emails. Please visit davidfeldmanshow.com. Hit the contact button. I answer all your emails. If you enjoyed today's show and you would like to share the knowledge and share the laughter, there's a very simple way to do that. Copy and paste the link.
and email it to all your friends, or share it. There are some share buttons on the device you're listening to, so I can't really, you know, I'm not Barack Obama, I'm not, you know, tapping your microwave, so I don't really know how you listen to this show. There's a way to share it, and that's all I ask, is that you share the knowledge. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, you sad, pathetic hump.